The crop circle team is on the trail. There's been another finding overnight, and they're gathering evidence. One, Richard, bumps into a lone enthusiast hungry for knowledge. Have there been too many people to gather good evidence?
You see if human beings have been in, and that'll tell you.
Busty Taylor's been investigating circles for years. This latest could be a man-made hoax. Evidence is needed to establish authenticity.
24.9 meters long.
The type of crop damage gives an indication, but the primary tool when testing is dowsing. Busty and Richard will know whether it's genuine or not by the twitching of the testing rods. Wherever ley lines meet, it seems, there are circles.
And this allows me then to measure how far out the rings are.
Dowsing has become the main weapon in the fight for the truth about crop circles. Small armies of croppies gather each year. They can pay up to £100 a day to discern the divining techniques.
And there's no physical movement of your fingers. That's the difficult one to stop any physical response there. And just
they want to track circles by unearthing ley lines. Today's test is to find one of the energy lines which are present throughout this site in Glastonbury. The rods have to move independently. The fingers mustn't move.
Just about there, there's something important. I don't know what it is. It's important enough to take a major energy line like this and split it and come in again.
Crop circles make for important business. But hang on a minute, aren't they just a gigantic hoax? Certainly Colin Lugg at the Swan in Devizes thinks so. He even offers, perhaps in jest, circles made to measure.
Some guests, I say to them, if you book your shape at night, I'll get somebody to do it for you in the morning. But and they look at me quite worried. But then they like it.
Where did this all begin? The West, and Wiltshire in particular, has always been associated with mystery, the paranormal, the out of the ordinary. The beauty and scale of Stonehenge has attracted visitors for centuries. Man-made Iron Age developments at Silbury Hill, the stones at Avebury, and the nearby barrows have all become magnets for tourists and academics alike. The late 70s and early 80s brought another attraction, crop circles. The huge, inexplicable shapes attracted worldwide attention. There were those who wanted to commune with the paranormal. There were those who believed important things were happening which needed to be researched. In the fields, semi-permanent sites were established to try and solve the mystery. Did they originate from deep within the Earth's crust? Were they evidence of visitors from another planet? Were they a giant hoax? Thousands of man-hours have been spent on the search for the truth.
We've added here a lot of scientific apparatus. The whole objective of getting to the bottom of the circle's mystery is to do more than just get film of circles forming. We need to be able to say eventually just how it is they form. One's got to know what's going on, what's happening to the atmosphere at the time that circles form.
Croppies gathered in other croppies for detailed debate about their findings at conferences. Busty and Richard were spreading the word.
And they've all said that it's nothing to do with their film or it's nothing mechanical by the camera.
Busty and myself are doing a piece on things that have just happened, and then later there will be the answering session, which will give you a whole answers to all the things that people require, really.
People required different things from the circles. Some thought they had healing powers.
And I felt it was extremely warm, and tremendously healing energy came in. I think that the whole phenomenon of the circles is an effort on the part of the Earth reality to compensate for our excessive materialism, not the materialism of our civilization so much as the materialism of the way we actually look at reality and the thoughts we form about it. And I think reality is beginning to kick back in that way, and responding to that in a positive way has a very healing effect anyway.
The circles mostly appeared along roadsides. and there were those who thought the circles were all hoaxes, the work of students, young farmers, or locals with too much time on their hands and perhaps too much of the strong local brew inside them. Hoax or heavenly bodies, prank or paranormal, the circles were beginning to attract that most earthly of objects, money. Croppies paid to commune with the paranormal. The passing trade joined the queue, just in case they were missing out. You could even buy the t-shirt. As long as the circle trade was unofficial, where was the harm? And certainly local businesses began to benefit. By the early 90s, the circles were appearing by the hundred. Pubs like the Barge at Honeytree in Wiltshire converted their gardens into large campsites. Inside, one room was set aside as a crop circle shrine.
It's developed over the last 5 years, and some seriologists approached us to see whether they could have somewhere as a centre for crop circles and seriology plus UFOs and what have you. Also with the carving stones that you see around the pub that attracts, and the big stone gate post out at the front, which also has a crop circle pattern on it.
Where do they come from then, these visitors?
They come from Canada, the States, Italy, France, Belgium, Holland, Japan also, and even we've had some from Australia and New Zealand.
And as the room increasingly became a mecca for croppies, so the Barge's business boomed.
Very, very busy. The campsite is normally full with campers, and probably 90% of those are interested in the crop circles. Also, the bar and through here gets full, and there's always a lot of discussion amongst various nationalities.
At the Black Swan Hotel in Devizes, pulling pints is never easier than when the circles appear. Take the trade away and landlord Colin Lugg would spot the difference.
They come to see Stonehenge, Avery, crop circles, so if anything's on par with Stonehenge and Avery, then it's got to be, you know, important. But, yeah, they all know about the crop circles.
But what about his guests? Colin seems unperturbed about claims that the circles are a hoax.
They bring customers in. I was born and bred in the area. There's always been some sort of form of prop circles. They're getting more intricate now, but I don't mind. I've no opinion on it.
Whilst you might expect pubs and hotels to cash in, the last group you would think would cash in on the crop circles are the farmers. After all, it's their crops which are being ruined. Indeed, the NFU in Hampshire even posted a £2,000 reward for information leading to the arrest of anybody found damaging crops. But in Wiltshire, some farmers have taken a more pragmatic view. Tim Carson is the chairman of the local branch of the National Farmers Union. He, like a handful of others, has posted specially hired staff to sell tickets to step inside the crop circles. He had T-shirts printed, as well as souvenir mugs and keyrings. He sold out.
I actually did try and stop them going in to start with, but that was a lost cause. And then I had someone there directing them the best way to go to minimise damage, and then just started charging people £1 to go in. I mean, it's up to the individual farmer what he wants to do. My neighbour doesn't like people going on. Unfortunately, people will go on when the farmer's not there. So you've got a choice. You can either be there all day and charge people to do it, or you just put up with it. Once the crop circle's there, the crop is damaged, and there's nothing you can do about it.
And does that annoy you somewhat?
It does. I mean, I'm not happy to see them, because it's damaging part of your livelihood. But at the same time, if the enough people come and you charge, you get compensated for it in a small way.
And there are other compensations. Tim even sold a Japanese car manufacturer the right to make a crop shape in his best field.
Where it comes from, no one knows. This is Emma Kurtz, SNTS News.
That was probably my most profitable quarter of an acre this year.
Pubs, hotels, even farmers are cashing in on the crop circles. But crop circle enthusiasts themselves have turned the enigma into revenue. Many have organised themed weekends. This one, up the road in Glastonbury, teaches the art of dowsing.
fine. You're getting something. Now bring them forward again and say, show me more of it, show me the center.
Dowsing is believed to be a way of finding underground energy or ley lines, and one theory has suggested that crop circles appear at the intersection of ley lines. Those who enlisted in this course may well have paid £100 or more for 2 days of lessons. That fee will not include hotel accommodation or food. Hamish Miller, who runs the course, has discovered that many circles appear along the so-called Michael and Mary energy lines, which run through the west.
There are 14 corn circles within very close range of the Michael and Mary line. So there is a connection. There are certain, each one is connected to the ancient landscape in some way, but not necessarily connected to the Michael and Mary line. Down through the church.
Hamish and these paying visitors sincerely believe that the circles are telling us something. And visitors travel enormous distances to sample the mystery of the circle. This American website offers week-long tours through Wiltshire during a peak time of crop circle activity. At $2,200, it might seem expensive, but the tours sell out year in and year out, and nobody's been unlucky enough to book a week when there wasn't a crop circle. With tens of thousands of visitors to the west specifically coming to see crop circles, the tourist trade revenue is clearly good, and tourism is important in this part of the west. Karen Kellard is a tourist officer at Kennet District Council.
Tourism is extremely important to the district, especially with the demise of the defence industry. So tourism is something that is replacing that and is very important to us. Croppies, as they're, as they're known, do come in vast numbers.
Crop circles do play their part in generating revenue. Indeed, in one internal magazine, quickly followed up by a local newspaper and then a national newspaper, tourist officials in the Kennet District of Wiltshire suggested that crop circle tourism could be harnessed by local businesses. They seemed to be saying, if you can't beat them, sell them. At Crop Circle Centre, evidence of hoaxes couldn't be further from the mind of researchers. Indeed, there is growing evidence, according to the scientist Terence Meaden, to suggest a cause of the crop circle.
My basic original idea that a vortex formed naturally in the atmosphere is involved in this mystery has never changed. The idea that the vortex is ionized or electrified, namely a plasma vortex, I have made widely public for the last 3 years.
And there are many who would react angrily to suggestions that all circles are hoaxes. People like Busty Taylor and Richard Andrews, who spent a long time travelling around the Wiltshire and Hampshire countryside, searching for and then charting, photographing and filming crop circles. Of course, they also test the authenticity of what some call pictograms. Amongst the tests to prove a genuine circle, Busty and Richard use dowsing.
These are the two rods that we use for dowsing, which are for giving us an idea as whether the pattern that we expect to be there or should be there is there. If it isn't, then we know that we have a hoax. But if it is, then we look at the other things that start to make a true pictogram.
The dowsing duo have given up countless hours of their own time in pursuit of the truth. They believe the circles attract thousands because they're paranormal and are an attempt by something, somewhere, to communicate with late 20th century mankind. But to prove their point, they need to disprove that the circles are hoaxes. And that's what today is all about.
We found the line which starts here, and this shows you how wide it is. It's going at 90 degrees. Now there it cuts off, which is what we would expect to find if that was flowing that way. It's actually firing off from one side of a line.
The early signs are encouraging. Dowsing has turned up the right sort of evidence. Busty now takes his camera poles deeper into the field to get an aerial shot. The stills are captured. Now the moving pictures as Busty gets out the video camera.
With a camera of that weight, it is very difficult to control, really, especially when you're bringing it down. But Busty is the most experienced person with a camera now on a pole.
Meanwhile, Richard is becoming convinced that this is a genuine circle.
One of the things I would expect on this far end here is that that line that we dowsed going through will actually, it will actually have grounded. In other words, the heads will have gone to the other side of that line. We will go around and just see if that has happened. It says the side that it fired off, and if you look across here, you can just see how that has fired off on that side.
Busty is back in the circle and has found evidence of human interference. It's either a hoax or, perhaps, interested croppies having measured the circle.
Again, at this point, you can see where a heel has rested. But if someone was walking the edge, like we very often do with a taper, it would give that effect all the way through. And I presume someone has measured it, because there is a stake hole in the centre, 6 inches deep. And so someone's been here and measured this already.
A hole in the centre where a man-made pole might sit. Footmarks around the edge. But Busty and Richard's dowsing evidence is too strong. This is an authentic crop circle. But is it a mystery? Let's meet John Lundberg. He's designing a crop circle. That's because he makes them. He's a hoaxer.
I mean, it's all very, very low tech. We use instruments called stalk stompers, which are a plank of wood with a 4-foot loop of rope. You would put the plank onto your foot and you would just walk forward. And as you walk forward, you flatten the crop. The other tools we use is just a surveying tape. So we actually create a human compass with one person in the center as a pivot and the other person moving around on the outside to actually scribe the outside of a ring. It's, you know, it's all very, very straightforward, and I can see why people say that. How can you make these things? But you know, these are people who've never been out in the fields and never tried to make them. So they're not informed. I mean, it is possible. It's very, very quick to flatten wheat. And you can make a formation that is, you know, 400 foot across easily in under 4 hours in the dead of night.
How many of you
have I made?
No, like, how many people will it take to do that?
Oh, it varies, but usually a team of 3 or 4 people will suffice.
Karen, can you see anything wrong with what's happening?
Well, it depends how it's happening. If people are actually being conned, then I can see something wrong in it. But at the moment, no one has any real idea why or how these circles appear. So we have to accept that we're going to have visitors and do our best to help them when they come into the district.
So you're making money out of the mystery?
Absolutely.
Here is next year's 1999 crop circle calendar.
Uh-huh.
Now, could you glance through those and tell us whether you think that any have been made by paranormal activity alone, or that all of them have been made by human hand?
Well, I can't tell you if any have been made by paranormal activity, but I can certainly tell you that I have not been involved in making all of these circles. In fact, I've probably been involved in making only 10% of the circles here.
Okay. So 2 or 3 of those circles have been made by you and your friends.
Mm-hmm.
You're not prepared to tell us which ones, are you?
I mean, as a group, we have a policy of never claiming formations. I mean, we're quite happy to speak about what we do, but like I say, you know, they're our artworks, and if we claim it, we kill it.
Okay. So presumably there are other groups like you of artists going around and doing it.
But there is only one other active group, as far as we know.
And would you put some of that work probably down to them?
Yes.
Francine Blake made the calendar that John believes has at least 5 hoaxers featured. She, however, rejects the claim that the majority are hoaxers.
In practical terms, to do these formations at night under criminal circumstances it doesn't happen very often. It is the fear that it happens, but it doesn't, in actual fact, I don't think it happens very often. They've never been seen, we've never caught hoaxers, and these fields are watched continuously.
We do try and take precautions. I mean, we try and gather as much intelligence on where people are going to be and what fields they're going to be watching. But at the end of the day, I think the researchers aren't really interested in catching us.
And speaking during one frantic year of circle activity, scientists argued that elaborate shapes might be a hoax, but not simple circles.
The problem is a genuine one. There is no hoax, so far as the phenomenon goes. Of course, anybody can come along and carve out a circle. We could go and make one in 5 minutes there in the next field, and it'll look dreadful. Or we could spend 10 hours trying to make a rather better one, and it'll still look dreadful.
To John Lundberg, crop circle hoaxing is just a bit of fun. He and his friends have established an award-winning website heralding their work. If you visit circlemakers.org, you could even see pictures of them making a crop circle.
We've made upwards of 198 circles in a single night on one formation.
Little circles.
Of various sizes, maybe some will be 60 foot down to 4 foot circles. And you know, it's a game. We make the crop circles. They love and research the crop circles. The tourist board make money out of the crop circles, and everybody's happy. So I don't think anybody really wants to catch us.
So while there's even a possibility that crop circles are all a hoax, should tourist information centres really be promoting them as a visitor pursuit? Karen Kellard believes there is, however, a distinction between promoting and servicing a need.
We don't sort of advocate the visiting of crop circles, but there are vast numbers of people that come into the area looking for them. And as an information point, we find that, you know, people could be roaming all over the area, that if they're told in the what vicinity they're in, we are actually helping that visitor, but we're not promoting that they go into the fields.
Of course they promote it. I mean, it's, why not? I mean, it is, it's, you know, it's part and parcel of the Wiltshire tourist industry. Of course it is. I mean, since the late 80s it's been, and for them to ignore it is patently stupid.
Indeed, some croppy researchers confirm the view that tourist officials are milking the circle enigma.
I've been asked by the tourism if there were tours going on, if I would take people in, but I haven't done it.
I mean, actually, on the way down here, I popped into the Chippenham Tourist Information Centre, and they have a huge catalogue of press clippings there, and they're saying, and they have books on crop circles as well, and they're saying how they're actually quite happy to help people find exact formations when they come into the area. I mean, people come here to find the crop circles, and the Tourist Information Board will actually, you know, will point them in the right direction.
It's the classic chicken and egg situation. The tourist officers won't officially promote the crop circles, but they do feel that they have to help visitors by guiding them in the direction of the crop circles. In fact, to do otherwise, they say, would mean traffic chaos.
It was felt that if people were coming in vast quantities, the last thing that was wanted in the whole of Wiltshire, not just Kennet, was people roaming around sort of, you know, in all the country areas, not knowing where they were going, what they were doing, and causing considerable jamming to the roads.
As for the hoaxers, they say they're happy to have their work appreciated and don't mind the exploitation.
Well, we refer to ourselves as circle makers. We're groups of individuals who go out and make crop circles every summer. And, you know, we're groups of artists, so we view the crop circles as our artworks. That's our motivation. I mean, we see the researchers now, I mean, the tourist board, as acting as our agents. I mean, they promote our work. So, you know, I certainly don't begrudge anybody making money out of the circles we make. I fully encourage it.
But if the tourist officers are the agents for the artists, it's not the artists who are making the money. It's the pubs, hotels, and of course, sometimes, even the farmers.
I know of a story. In 1996, there was a formation at Stonehenge. And we know for a fact that the farmer made £30,000 that season, and the formation was getting more visitors than the Henge at one point. But again, it's fine. I mean, what we do is illegal. I don't have a moral leg to stand on, and if we get caught, it's a fair cop. And if the farmers can charge for the formations, then I think that's great, because then they don't bear us any malice.
Do you think the farmers don't bear you any malice? I mean, some members of the NFU have said, you know, this is criminal damage. Stop it, you know, we want them arrested. There's even a reward been posted, hasn't there?
Yeah, I mean, there is a certain amount of hypocrisy, I think. If it's the farmers who are putting pressure on the tourist authority, it's also the farmers who are putting pressure on the National Farmers Union, who, the Hampshire group of the National Farmers Union have offered a £2,000 reward for our arrest. So I think there is a certain amount of hypocrisy there.
And some farmers agree. They do think it is hypocritical to exploit the circles and don't want hoaxers like John on their land. So tourist officials become very sensitive about allegations that they're selling crop circles as a tourist attraction. But there is, of course, a distinction between promotion and exploitation.
At the end of the day, it isn't something that I'm doing or my council is doing to bring people into the area. It is very much something that has grown over the years. And I have to say, the media have actually increased the number of visitors by their articles. We had a lot of coverage in the national press and TV this year, which then hypes the thing up and causes more people to come.
But you encourage that, really, don't you?
Well, we don't actively encourage it. What we do is we reap the benefits from it, but in no way do we encourage coverage on crop circles, because it's not something that the district council wants to promote.
Describe the trade as you will, fleecing the tourists or reaping the benefits of inquisitive visitors. Con or inexplicable concept, art or criminal damage. Nobody can deny circles are a major cash crop, and the good folk of Wiltshire, at least some of them, aren't complaining. Not farmers, well, not all of them anyway. Not pubs, not hotels, not croppy researchers.
I think tourism is controversial always. There's always a downside. There's an upside for some people and a downside for others. You know, this pub lives off tourism from Crop Circle, and it has done for some years, so they're very happy. The village isn't so happy. So it is difficult, particularly with a subject like crop circles, which happens on people's private land.
But if some of them are hoaxes, aren't these tourist officers selling a con? No, because, I mean, people are just interested to see, you know, art and crops, be it hoaxed or genuine. I mean, genuine could be hoaxed, but no one's come up with the answer yet.
If it's tourists, their time is limited. So if they can go straight to a crop circle, that's good. I mean, I send them to the barge at Honey Street to... they were told the latest ones, what's happened that morning or that day. And yeah, they haven't got time to waste sort of driving all around the countryside trying to find them. So it's nice to sort of have that information on hand.
Simon, it could be argued that the tourist office is contributing to what is, in effect, selling a con. Classic seriologists and some farmers might object to crop circles, or people going into the crop circles, but the fact is they are there, and the tourist office should be promoting something that is an attraction.
So if it's good for business, it doesn't matter whether it's con or not.
Exactly.
They come to see crop circles, and that's what we make.
They come on the basis that the crop circle has been made by paranormal activity. It's made by you.
Not all of them.
Crop circles do bring in a lot of visitors, and as that's the case, why not, you know, make hay while the sun shines? Because how long is it before something might explode and the lid might come off, and then there'll be no crop circles